Welcome back to Let's Interactively Play Steve Jackson's Sorcery. My voice is much improved, still a little scratchy, and the guy thinks that's funny. Anyway, 3 out of 4 of you said I should talk to this guy. I wish I had more people interacting, you know, so if you're hesitant on interacting, please do interact, because I'm not getting a lot of comments. Anyway, so as you guys may or may not have remembered, there was this fight. We got a whole bunch of gold stolen. I hope we get some back. I think we had 15, 16, something like that. Yeah. In a tumult, you wait for an opportunity. In every fight, there will always be some gold pouches swinging low for the plucking. You are knocked about a fair bit as you wait, but finally you see a bulging wallet just inches from your grasp. Glancing up at the owner of the wallet, you find yourself staring into the huge face of a mountain man.
You're a thief, aren't you?
The man asks. And majority says, talk my way out of it. And it's a fight. I'm no thief, you tell him. I bet he's got plenty of gold on him, remarks another voice nearby in the crowd. It's a trigger that sends the mountain man, who has just been robbed himself, into a fearsome rage. And the fist fight damage is lower and power refreshes more quickly. Okay. I'm going to start out blocking because he's going into a fearsome rage. And nothing happened. The mountain man raises his stone-like fist deceptively, or defensively, sorry. You put up your own and circle. The mountain man steps back. They're laughing at us. Cool. He doesn't have much stamina, I just noticed that. You set your stance. Look out! Someone nearby calls, but it's too late. Hurrying forward quickly, you aim to break his skull. I don't think I can break his skull with my bare hands. He lifts his guard to cover himself. The mountain man gestures for you to try and hit him. We get power back quickly. I'm gonna do a thump. I don't know if it matters from here to here. I guess it does. Like between, like the different variations of thump. So I'm going to do a light thump, if it makes a difference. Nice. You maintain the momentum. You shove him backwards into the cloth canopy of a tent. The mountain man grabs a nearby crowd member and tries to throw him at you, but you dodge and punch him twice in the temple. The mountain man stops and spits blood into the dirt. The muscles in his arm tighten. I'm going to block this time to get some attack power back. Good. You would have had it done quite a bit to have to beat a 6.2. You drop back, lifting your fists. Let's see what that skull of yours is made of, he declares, as he comes at you regardless. You block his hammer-strong blows, leaving him panting. The mountain man dodges back. He's going for the kill. Boom. Enough of this. You grab a nearby bottle and break it against his head. He ducks quickly to one side. Like wrestling a fish, he teases. The mountain man goads you. Cool. Done. Quickest battle ever, guys. And the easiest one. You launch at him again. You launch a heavy punch for his throat. The final punch makes the mountain man's head spin. Oh, never mind, he curses, throwing up his hands. Keep your gold, thief. With that, he stomps away, punching a few other people as he goes. One stamina lost. Brilliant boxing. You slither your way back out of the crowd to the main part of the fair. We need our money back. What the hell? This did not turn out the way I wanted it to. I hope we catch up. We're really poor right now. I've been having a problem being poor in this game. You walk to the north end of the fairground midway. The fair continues from here, and a road leads away uphill. Hmm. Let's check out these musicians. I desperately want my money back, guys. You have a head over to where a crowd are watching a troupe of dancers who spin and twirl in time to a lively tune. There's something quite hypnotic about the performance. I don't know what I cast a spell for. Let's keep watching. The pitch builds and the music speeds up. The crowd claps and stomps their feet, and you find yourself clapping along as well, quite enjoying the show. The dancers are now twirling into the audience, pulling onlookers into the dance. One is getting quite close to you. I don't want to get pickpocketed again. Avoid. You hang back, avoiding the invitation, but your reluctance doesn't go unnoticed. Where's your spirit? Demands a creature to one side of you. Another snarls more menacingly. Go on. It's only a bit of fun. Another dancer is coming close. Arm outstretched. Sure, why the hell not? I'm watching my 7 gold, guys. The pressure of the crowd has changed your heart. You grab the outstretched hand of the dancer, who whips you away into the center of the crowd. The music grows in tempo, and soon you are swirling, sky wheeling overhead, thrown from one partner to the next. It is kind of funny. Onlooking creatures cheer and whoop and clap their claws together, and for a brief moment you feel like you are the toast of all Kharé. Keep track of my purse. Then you realize that, as you pass from one dancer to the next, your gold purse could be snatched at any moment, so you grab hold of it to keep it safe. But in doing so, you stop watching what you're doing. When the next dancer hurls you across the circle, you trip, landing in a messy heap. Spectating creatures laugh and jeer. Well, thanks, and a dog barks. Eventually, the music fades and the dance finishes. One of the dancers comes over to sit beside you. I hope you're not too bruised, friend, he says. Some people find the thieves dance too fast for them. The thieves dance? You ask. The musician shrugs. It's just a name. He looks you over with a canny eye. Well, he says, I don't think you're going to cause any trouble for us, are you? Enjoy the rest of the festival and try to stay upright this time. He heads off into the crowd. Okay. We need rations. We need money. I could do something more here. You walk back to the middle of the fairground and look around. Oh, that doesn't... No. I got the end. Got the top. Oh, no, no. Wait, wait. I don't know what the hell that was. It was a rewind thing, but there was no button. Can we... Thank you. You walk back up to the north end of the fairground midway. The fair continues from here, and a road leads away uphill. And a man laughs. Bare-knuckle fighting. You cross the fairground to a wrestling ring. A ruffian inside is announcing the current challenge. People of Kharé, are you ready for a fight? In the white corner, we have our challenger, Anvar the Barbarian. It looks like Slash from Guns N' Roses. The crowd cheers and whoops. Look over Anvar. Anvar is about half as tall as you again, with sheets of muscle on his arms and legs, but he is probably lighter than the ogre, which will mean he has less momentum. And in the black corner, the brawling champion of Kharé, the one they call Skull Splitter, the ogre Kagu of Dadule. Look over Skull Splitter. The ogre looks as thick as any ogre you might meet, but he is made of solid muscle, his arms and legs like the twisted bark of trees. Challenger, are you ready? Demands the ruffian. Anvar nods and beats his chest. Ask someone about the fight. You attract the attention of a nearby member of the crowd. Tell me, you ask, what are the rules of the fight? No rules, giggles the man in reply. That's what makes it so entertaining. No weapons, another man puts in. That's the only rule. On the platform, the ruffian turns to the ogre. Champion, are you ready? The beast appears not to understand the question, but scratches his armpits. The ruffian nods. Does me say that? And who can challenge, you ask? The man shrugs. Anyone crazy enough to want to get their head smashed in. The ruffian steps into the center of the ring and drops his arms. Let the fight begin. The crowd roars, ready for the fight. The barbarian in the white corner growls and beats his chest. The ogre raises his fists into the air and shakes them. I kind of like Slash. Let's shout for the barbarian. Slash! 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 You shout, finish him! To the barbarian, who bellows with anger. The barbarian beats his chest and pounds the ogre heavily about the head. Suddenly, Anvar is looking good. Well, we can't bet now. It's too late. Cast a spell. Where's my list? You ever wonder if we could cast some kind of buff on him? That'd be cool, wouldn't it? What if we... Let's see if we have S, K, T, and D. What if we cast a mirror image on Anvar? That'd be cool, wouldn't it? We can't. It's only SA. I wish you could. Sap. Foe loses morale. Ah! I should have bet on Anvar and then have... That would be great, but I still want to see it. Alright. Foe loses morale. Or causes depression. Whatever. Sap. You ready the spell. Cast it over the ogre. I should have... Oh man, I need that money. I want to go back, but that's cheating. Ah. Cast it on the ogre. You cast the enchantment over the ogre, who begins to look thoroughly miserable. The fight is firmly against a skull splitter now. Finally, it is all over. With a single throw, Anvar the barbarian powers forward and hurls skull splitter to the mat. The crowd goes wild. What is with crowd is a noun. Even though it's a group of people, it's a singular noun. So the sentence should read, the crowd goes wild. Sorry, guys. Inside the ring, the master of the fight raises the barbarian's fist in the air. Who challenges our champion? The prize is 10 gold pieces. Oh, we really need that, don't we? And we have a bunch of stamina left. I have to. I challenge him, you cry. All eyes turn to look at you. The fight master beams. We have a stranger taking the challenge, he declares. Let her through. Into the ring we go. The crowd parts and you are helped up into the ring. Under his breath, the fight master outlines the rules. A fair fight, no magic, and pound your opponent until they can't stand. Ready? He asks. Let's look over the barbarian. You look over your opponent. He is almost half as tall as you again, with muscles on his chest and arms like sculpted wax. In the black corner then, the ruffian announces. In is Anvar. In the white corner? The ruffian turns to you and hisses. What should I call you? Analander? The Stranger. I like that. Mysterious. The stranger! The ruffian pulls a blank face. It's not very exciting, he says, but all right. To the crowd, he bellows, in the white corner today, fresh from who knows where, please welcome to the ring the stranger herself. And then throws you a sidelong glance before he scarpers from the ring. Let's get ready to rumble! The crowd begins to furiously place bets. You can hear them discussing your relative merits. She looks feeble. Looks like a maniac to me. You ready your fists. Oh, I'm a maniac. That's right, baby. We'll start with a little experimental jab. And that was... Ouch. The barbarian raises his fists into the air and roars. The crowd roars in return. You drop your weight and keep your arms open, hoping you have scared Anvar into fighting cautiously. Anvar charges straight at you. He strikes you hard and you are sent flying backwards into the mat. Alright. Bash him. Boom. Readying a forceful blow, you hurtle forwards. The barbarian blocks your blow. I'm gonna block this time. You drop into a defensive crouch. Anvar is performing for the crowd, making a circuit of the ring as he comes to knock you down. You dodge the blow when he passes, and he frowns stupidly in annoyance. I'm gonna bash him again. Nice. Performing a heavy swing, you charge for your opponent. The barbarian drops into a defensive crouch, moving with more speed than you expect. We need to get... We still have that much, huh? I'm gonna block. Oh, crap. I should have hit him. You drop back defensively. The barbarian peers at you in return through his floppy fringe. He beats his huge chest and roars. Yeah, for Slash, he has a lot of more muscle than I thought he would. Oh, crap. You charge forward, trying to grab the barbarian's full weight and hurl him from the ring, but Anvar's own thump is a heavy one. You are thrown to the floor. The crowd gasps and cheers. He steps backwards across the ring, putting space between you. Blocking again. You drop your weight and watch Anvar closely. The barbarian thumps hard, but you dodge most of the blow. He is holding back. Someone in the crowd is shouting advice. Body blow time. Cool. Mastering a lumberjack blow, you lunge at the barbarian. He turns away, as though confused as to exactly where you are. Perhaps he cannot see past this fringe after all. Wow, beating the crap out of him. You strike again. Readying a forceful swing, you hurtle forwards. The barbarian deflects your fists. The crowd are spurring on Anvar. Take her down, someone calls. Oh, he's gonna take me down. Oh, don't take me downtown. You try a weighty punch, but Anvar attacks with all his strength, pounding your head on both sides. Ouch. Oh, I just barely won that one. I got two off him. That's nice. Moving swiftly, you aim for his midriff as the barbarian swings for your head. Anvar staggers suddenly, crashing into the ropes at the side of the ring. A gasp goes up from the crowd. Anvar pauses to wave to his fans in the crowd, and while he is waving, I bash him. You lunge forwards again. Moving quickly, you go for a straight lunge for his temple. The barbarian tries to dodge. Anvar grunts with frustration as he turns about twice and hits the mat. For a moment, you even think he might stay down, but shaking his stupid head, he pricks himself to his feet once more. He batters at his broad, rippling head and bellows. One more time. Ah. Oh, damn it. You throw a heavy blow, but Anvar's response is strong and devastating. You are thrown heavily into the ropes. The crowd applauds and whoops. Anvar beats his chest and pauses to lift his arms to the crowd, while who roar in approval. Okay, crap. I keep thinking he's distracted when he does that. You swing a hard hit, but the barbarian grabs you and knees you in the midriff, locking the wind from your chest. He is hovering slightly. The crowd are now behind you, spurring you on. I'm gonna block this time. God, I could have overcome that easily. You drop into a defensive crouch. The barbarian tries a weak punch, but you duck out of the crowd. Out of the way. The crowd, friendly against you, smash her face in, one calls in. Thump! Bye-bye. Preparing a heavy blow, you charge for your opponent. Anvar staggers back, gasping, his face a mess of blood and bruises. Summoning the last ounce of strength in your arms, you ready a final knockout punch that sends him back across the mat and out of the ring. 12 stamina lost, pounded. You stagger from the ring, the crowd cheering for you, and collect your winnings. Yay! Well, that is more than what we came in with. I think we came in with 16... 15? Okay. Now all we need is rations. Whoop. If I can get my money back that was lost, that would be even better. I lost my mouse pointer for a second. Lost all among this, this map. End of the line. You push your way through the crowd, following the road uphill. The party is getting wilder, and you would do well to be away from here before things get out of hand. At the edged forage of the fair, the litter has left a tide mark on the grass. There is one last small tent here, probably a ticket booth that has simply been ignored by the crowds of Kharé. Look at the small tent. Looking more closely, you spot a sign above its door. Cabinet of Fortune. Try your luck. A prize for all. Look back. Looking back, you see what looks like one of the tents going up in flames. It must be part of the entertainment, as no one seems too concerned. In fact, a great cheer goes up as one of the strings of flags collapses into the bonfire. Ahead, the crowd continues through empty fields and patches of rubble-strewn wasteland. But it climbs, so it must be heading for the center of Kharé. Stream rises from a large building beside a fork in the road. You have time to test your luck. No doubt, if you wanted. Alright, let's try the Cabinet of Fortune. You go over to the tent and push back the flap. Inside, a grubby, bearded man leaps up from where he was sitting cross-legged on the floor and comes over to pump your hand. This looks like a giant, like, bug, like a fly or something. The hell is that thing? Welcome, welcome, my friend, he exclaims, somewhat over-enthusiastically, and let's see what prize you can win today. You must know this. There are no losers at the honest Hanna-Barbera... No, never mind. Hanna's Cabinet of Fortune. He gestures with one hand towards a large glass cabinet in the center of the tent. Look inside the cabinet. Now, you know what? Yeah, let's look inside. You step forward and peer in through the glass. Inside there are piles of jewelry, books, gold, and other things, as well as a small, wiry creature, curled up fast asleep. Huh. What is that creature? You ask. My little pet, Hanna exclaims. He's perfectly harmless. Well, he bites, but only when you open the cabinet to feed him. Huh. What do I do? You ask. It's a most simple game, honest Hanna replies with glee. You give me 2 gold pieces, and then my little pet will fetch something for you. Huh. I don't want to cast a spell. I'm so low on stamina. I would cast a trap spell. We need to find some rations real bad. Pay him. You paid 2 gold pieces and Hanna goes over to the cabinet and presses a small button on the side. It seems to operate a cantilevered spike which pokes the creature, who squeals, jumps from its perch, and begins fluttering around inside the case. What now? You could try to influence its choice by shouting at it, Hanna explains. The angrier you can make it, the better the prize, usually. I'm not sure why. As if to make the point, the creature picks up a ruby ring, then smiles, and drops it, and flies up to the top of the tank. Well, I've already given him his money. I'm going to play. Although it does not seem very fair, you determine to infuriate the creature as much as possible. I don't know why. I want to see what happens if I yell, "Freedom!" The creature in the tank flops around gently. What else could you try? Stupid creature. The strange mite is still flying around with glowing eyes. There must be something that will get this creature to truly see red. Hanna? If you say his name, he gets pissed. The flying thing circles around furiously. Eventually, the creature selects something from the prize pool, which it dumps into a chute at the far side of the cabinet. You open the flat and remove a bamboo pipe. Please, you nod to Hanna, then you head back out of the tent. A bamboo pipe. I'm pretty sure that's for one of the spells. Hold on. Bamboo pipe. So glad I wrote all this crap down. It's easier than flipping through that thing. Bamboo flute? is for the jig spell, which is a kind of like an uncontrollable dancing thing. That's neat. Let's take a look at it anyway. Does it go into treasure? So it's just money. Magical items? Bamboo flute. Oh, we stole this blimberry juice! I'm probably gonna drink one of these soon, if we can't find some. A torn note. Alright. Keys. I would like some better items and stuff. Anyway, Mansion Row, huh? This is a really big city. Dwarf Town over here, I haven't been to. Artist Quarter. Palatine Hill, or Palatine Hill, docks. And then across, we got the Red Quarter, North Gate, Fireview Square, Halls of Vlada, Fallen Quarter, and ooh, the Necropolis. And the Gardens of Briar. This is all very interesting. We've hardly seen any of it. We've gone here and then upward into the Festival of Thieves. Which I say, I'm not sure if I knew it was called the Festival of Thieves necessarily. Okay, let's follow the road. You leave the fair behind you and climb through fields towards the outskirts of the buildings. I have much gold as I went in with, until you reach a fork in the road. The slum districts of Lower Kharé are unlikely places to find nobles, but you might be able to learn their names, or where they are hiding. In the elbow of the fork is a grand, well-kept building. Steam pumps from its roof. A creature emerges looking refreshed and flushed. It is a bathhouse. Okay, so we can go to the bathhouse, we can go to the cliff road, or we can head uphill. Let's just go to the bathhouse. You step in the cool of the bathhouse. It is a wide building of marble tiles and a sweet smell of pine and fresh wood. Gentle noises echo and murmur around the walls. A creature by the front desk greets you with a smile. "Good afternoon, my lady," it purrs. "The water is cool and fresh today. A swim costs 4 gold pieces." 4 gold pieces. Is it worth it? "Oh, very," the creature replies with a beaming smile. "The waters of Kharé are known for their healing and refreshing qualities. We have a steam room and a lagoon pool. You'll be well catered for." Well, maybe we can get all our stamina back. I really don't want to use 4 gold pieces, but I am curious about this place. And, maybe it'll give us all our stamina back. Probably a mistake, but I'm going to pay him. You hand over 4 gold pieces, and the concierge gestures you through into the center of the bathhouse, where a wide pool awaits, with trees and shrubs on either side. By the pool. I can hear my heartbeat. From across the room, steam curls from the doorway of a glass-doored room. You strip off and pile your clothes and belongings in one corner of the room. I don't want to leave my belongings. Let's swim. I got some stamina back. 4, I think. You dive into the pool and swim a few enjoyable lengths. You feel better for the exercise. You feel your shoulders unknotting and your body relaxing. Try the steam room. You enter the steam room and take a seat on one of the benches. The temperature is almost unbearable. Through the curling smoke, you see another figure in the shadows. You are not alone. Let's stay quiet. You stay quiet, minding your own business. After a while, you hear a voice murmuring, "Our last man failed." Makes you think you can succeed. You talking to me? Say nothing. You stay quiet. A moment later, a second voice replies, "That idiot tried head-on. You can't kill a wizard head-on. You have to go in when they're asleep. You have to have tactics." Good. The first voice in the smoke agrees. And I don't want to know what your tactics are. So long as your money is good, the second voice says. Keep listening. I am eavesdropping and being stealthy. You stay quiet and listen. Sansas. That's that one. Right. Sansas left me enough to cover all four jobs before he disappeared. Oh. Taking on the nobles? The first speaker says. Mulas and theater are done. The job on Shinva, well... The speaker huffs into the smoke. How do you kill someone? But only enough to make them a ghost. That was a tough one. You rack your brains for a moment. Aren't those the name of the city nobles? They sure are. I recognize the Mulas name. Not theater necessarily. But, yeah. This one should be the easiest. The second speaker agrees. Glad to hear it. But don't forget the last man who tried. He's a sideshow attraction now, I hear. I'm gonna keep listening. What happened? We got back more stamina? I won't, the second voice replies. So where's this noble's house? Red Quarter. Round the back of Fireview. You can't miss it. It's the biggest place in the neighborhood. He tells them all he's a scholar, but don't be fooled. The second voice grunts an assent. Then a figure stands and leaves the room. You've heard enough, and the heat is getting to be too much. You get to your feet as stealthily as you can and leave the room. You head back out of the steam room. Feeling much better, you turn and collect your belongings. Let's check them over. Not trusting the city to pass up the chance to rob you, you check through your belongings, but everything still seems to be in place. Pleased, you head for the exit. The creature at the front desk beams cheerfully at you. You step outside onto the street. You have found four new clues, and another clue has been updated. Nice. Clues. A clue! A clue! Okay, so, Lord Theta is one of the nobles of Kharé. Lord Shinva is dead and buried. However, there are rumors that his spirit still haunts his crypt in the Kharé necropolis. Oh, cool, we're just looking at that. The Scholar. One of the nobles of the Cityport is a scholar. And the scholar's house. The scholar lives in the Red Quarter of the city, in a large house close to Fireview Square. Cool, I'll have to remember that. Lord Mulas, remember that? Four nobles. Yep, cool. Still waiting for a choice. So we can end the episode, unless our choice is where to go. Artist's Quarter. Now the thing is, I want to explore as much of this city as I can. Because I remember the first chapter, if you went one way, you couldn't go back. So if I head uphill, will I still be able to go to the Artist's Quarter? What is uphill anyway? The docks. We're going to have to go to docks eventually anyway, right? Unless there's something around here. Unless this thing looks like maybe a well or something. Let's head this way. The cliff road. You head along the cliff road into an area of larger, more impressive buildings. The road passes through the ruin of a grand building. In what must have once been a glorious morning room, an ornamental pond is all that remains. Moss grows from the cracks in its tiled sides. The pond. Let's look at the pond. You walk over to the pond. Despite its great age, it seems well tended, and the water is surprisingly clear. A small scarlet fish darts out from behind a stone as you watch. Bubbles rise from its mouth, and as they break, you hear the breath of words. Something else glints from the bottom of the pool. Lean closer to hear the words. Kneeling beside the pond, you put your ear close to the water. I wouldn't get that close. A little scarlet fish swims up and spits a drop of water at your cheek. If fishes could laugh, you would swear this fish was chuckling. Again, it mouths bubbles, and they sound like... What does it mean? Look deeper into the pond. Your eyes traced a second gleam. Not a fish this time, but a gold piece. Someone must have thrown it into the water for luck. Can we take it? Are we going to get attacked by this fish? Oh, we got it. You dip your hand into the pool to grab the coin. The fish leaps out of the water to come after you, but it is not fast enough. You pocket the gold. Time to go! The road slopes downhill towards a large dome building. To the right, a narrow road winds uphill. That's pretty cool. Easy gold, hey? I'm gonna keep going this way because I do want to check out the artist's quarter and I don't want to like end up missing that. I don't know why, it sounds interesting to me. You follow the clifftop road, looking down over the road fields of Kharé. You can see workers, still breaking their backs in the setting sun. Halfway along you pass a creature with a signboard slung around his neck. Read the signboard. The board is painted with the message, "Doom comes. The world is ending." The creature notices your gaze and begins to approach. Talk to him? You stop the creature. "Greetings." The creature looks deep into your eyes.
"Stranger," he murmurs, "do you have a moment for salvation?"
"Always," you reply cheerfully.
"Kharé crumbles," the creature declares dramatically. "We tumble like a cliff into the sea. Do you know..."
Keep listening.
"And all who go there will be destroyed,"
the creature finishes. You blink. "Did you miss something?" The creature appears to be waiting for an answer. "You should tell more people than just me," you reply, hoping to encourage the creature to move on.
"The council has abandoned us," he replies. "There is a stir of revolution. The people live in fear, and they do not listen. Viva la revolution!"
A revolution?
"Fear." Sorry. "Fire burns in the deep," the creature replies. "A thousand angry voices wait to rise. Go below and you shall find the king."
Then he blinks suddenly, as though surprised to find himself on the street. You went funny. That's a nod to the... I think it's the first poltergeist. Yeah, pretty sure, not the second. So he was possessed or something. What king? You know, that ghost noble could have possessed him. What king? He's not going to know what I'm talking about. The creature looks startled, yelps, and runs away up the street. Yeah, we kind of have that effect on people. And creatures. Alright, still waiting for a decision. Into the plaza. This is a stone plaza where people meet to eat in the evenings. It is a busy spot, and the smell of sizzling meat and broth fills the air with sweet smoke. The main road leads away along the cliff, and another road leads left and upwards. Well, I'm entering the market. Let's head left. Hey. You slip into the shadow of the market. It is clearly after hours. The carpet and trinket sellers have packed away, boarding up their shop with planks, chains, gates, and the occasional troll guard. And instead, food vendors have set up along the winding corridors and intersecting passages of this great building. Okay. Wait. So we got a little sub-map here. That's pretty cool. Brandon Silent. The food stalls. The smells are incredible. Spites. We got some spites. Fresh spites, guys. Spices, meats, wine, and the echoes of slammed mugs and sizzling pans are almost deafening. Let's watch the people. We do need some rations, so hopefully we can find some like that here. You hang back a moment, watching the creatures passing by. Several are eating meals they carry with them on thick leaves, shoveling them into their mouths with forks, claws, or prehensile tongues. You can't help but noticing that most of them seem to be vegetarian, which is most curious. Vegetarian. Well, as long as they don't go preaching to me about the evils of meat, I'm fine. Let's find something to eat. You wander the corridors for a while, letting the smells tickle your stomach. There seems to be three main cuisines available. Hill fox broth, rat bear stew, and a lentil curry with strange orange vegetables. Okay. So, I'm assuming there's fox in this, and there's rat and bear in this, so... Unless, I don't know. Stuff that the rat and bear eat? Rats will eat anything. The meat is in general more expensive than the vegetables, costing 6 gold pieces instead of 4. Holy crap. That's half my money. Try to steal some food? Choose a stall to eat at. You turn your nose this way and that, enjoying the smells. Alright. So this is I'm hoping I won't be locked into this. I just want to look at it. Oh, crap. I am. Wait. I spent 6 gold pieces. Ugh. 6 gold pieces is a lot for a meal, but you pay it and instantly don't regret it. The broth is fantastic and makes you feel much better, even though you have already eaten once today. The black elf doing the cooking winks at you. Best in Kharé, he remarks, but don't tell anyone or the nobles will have me thrown in irons for greed. We're poor again, guys. I just can't seem to hold on to money. Tell me about the nobles. And stop laughing over there, guy. The elf shrugs. If you're going to rule a city like this one, you've got to be a certain type. But Sansus, he's the first noble, he's that type and twice over, and when he's done, there won't be many other nobles remaining. Apparently he got feared they'd spill the secret of the North Gate, so he's been picking them off one by one. Going to be a very quiet council chamber soon enough. How many nobles are left? Oh, they're all left, the elf replies. One's blind, one's half dead, and another's 3/4. He giggles. One retired, but only because he's a filthy sorcerer and Sansus couldn't get to him. But the gate secret will get out. I hear even the gods are against Sansus now. There have been omens. What omens? I couldn't say, the chief replies. Oh, chef replies. But enough that Sansus hasn't shown his face outside the council chamber for at least a month now. Now you'll have to excuse me. The chef nods to you and moves away to serve other customers. Hunger fully abated, you head for the exit once more. The market probably has several ways out, but it is thick with people, and after several minutes of wandering, you find yourself emerging back into the plaza you came in from. We found 2 new clues. Okay, so we can only leave. One of these clues. First Noble Sansus. First Noble of Kharé, the blind beggar. One of the nobles is now blind and begging. I pass someone who's looking for money. Didn't I? I think so. Can I go? How far out can I go? Cool. He was way back. Not him. Not the guy. We came across someone else, didn't we? Who's looking for money? I'm not even sure. We didn't give him any because I was broke. Like I am now. Center. Yeah. Alright, we're back outside. Going back outside. Long episode, guys. Sorry, hope you don't mind. It's just... there's no real choices here. Night has fallen. The main road leads back along the cliff, and another road leads away towards the wall. I mean, other than the choice of what to eat... Oh, we can still go all the way back here? I really thought there was, like, kids outside my window. That was pretty good. If I had left, what's around this way? Oh, there's, like, some kind of gate here? I don't know. I've been along here, right? Let's go left. I want the choice that you guys make to be something of like, that's important. Not just go this way or that way, or eat that food or that. You take the side road and climb up a winding street. It is quieter now, and there are fewer creatures on the streets. The streets are likely to be dangerous after dark. You should find somewhere to sleep. Keep walking. Well, I don't have a sleep thing flag here. All I have is keep walking. Someone's pulling a cart with many oxen. The road underfoot becomes better paved. You are in a residential street, but where the lower floors of the houses have all been covered up by boards. There is no one about, but from the windows of the higher stories you hear the sounds of people talking, carousing, arguing, and snoring. A little further along, and the road ends in a wall of stone, through which someone has hewn a narrow archway, perhaps with a mining pick. Squeezing through, you find yourself in a slightly wider lane that leaves left and right. A junction. Da-da-da. You stand almost at the foot of the city wall once more. The road runs from the right and uphill to the left. A fountain dribbles water into a stony bowl. You know, I'm thinking why the hell not, but why would I drink from the fountain? This place is like, if this place was like a holy city or something, then yeah, I'd do it, but I don't think it's a good idea. It's either not going to be good to drink, or we're going to get in trouble for doing it. And I don't think drinking from the fountain will restore stamina, and even if it did, we're not that bad with stamina, so let's move on. But which way? Circuitous route, huh? Either way kind of leads to the docks, right? Let's go this way. Come on, game, give me a choice. You follow the street past low slum buildings. On the step of one, a rough-looking girl sits, her knees drawn up to her chin. Spare coin? I don't think this is one of the nobles. I don't know. We've just been going for so long, guys. I know this isn't the best choice here, but what do you think? Shut up, dog. Ignore her. Tell her I don't have any gold, which is close enough. Or toss her a coin. We don't have a lot of gold. I don't know. What do you guys think? Which one? Put your choices, your comments below. And yeah. Thanks so much for watching, guys. See you in the next one. I'm looking forward to see what you guys have to say. What you think I should do at this point. If I had plenty of gold, I would just give her a coin. But I do not have 15, 16 like I did. I have 6. So, see you next time, guys. And endure. And enduring, grow strong.